Now, let's try to understand a few reinsurance kind of an arrangements and how typically we would be computing the various distributions associated with these reinsurance arrangements, and how do I typically compute what are the mean payments, variance of the payments that are done by the direct insurer as well as the reinsurer. Just to reiterate the concept of reinsurance, see, generally any claims that have been made by the customers, by the insured, by the policyholders, they have to be met. And but in this process, what the insurance companies typically do is, when the claim amount is very large, they themselves try to take an insurance policy against that claim with the reinsurance company, right? So that kind of policies are reinsurance policies, wherein there are many varieties of reinsurance. But just to understand the concept, in some cases it could be something associated with excess of loss, wherein up to a certain loss amount, up to a certain claim amount, the insurance company is going to pay, and any losses which are beyond it are handled by the reinsurance company. That is a excess of loss kind of a model. And the other one comes out to be a proportional reinsurance. Irrespective of the size of the loss, the payments typically are in some kind of a proportion, right? Now, just to see whatever, just as a terminology in this, whatever the claim that is incurred by the policyholder, it is called as the gross claim amount. And any kind of a claim that is typically subtracted because of the payment that is done by the reinsurer. Reinsurer settles some portion of the claim because of that reinsurance arrangement that he is having with the regular direct insurer. So that reinsurer's portion of the claim is subtracted, and which is what is resulting in a net claim amount. Now, the same logic gets applied to the premium also. The premium which is directly collected from the customer is called as gross premium. But out of that, the insurance company has to pay a portion of the premium to the reinsurer. Reinsurance premium is what which we may call it. The net is again going to be the net premium amount. So these things are basic terminologies which we really need to be comfortable with. And how we compute, or what is the typical mechanism of computing the expected claim amounts, or probably the variance in the claim amounts in case there is such kind of a reinsurance agreement. So that is what we are more interested to look at in this particular session. Now, for that, let me get started with the excess of loss reinsurance. As we said, we would primarily focus on two major forms of reinsurance, wherein the reinsurer is paying above a certain amount. So let's say some claim has come. Now, whatever is the claim amount, the insurer is going to settle that claim. If that claim amount is less than or equal to some constant, less than or equal to some constant M, which is what we are calling as the retention level. So insurer will take care of the payment of that much of claim amount as long as it is lesser than the retention level. But the moment the claim amount goes beyond the retention level, it is transferred to the reinsurer, and the reinsurer will pay the excess. This is what we call as the excess of loss reinsurer. So from an insurance company's perspective, we are clearly seeing that if the claim amount let's say is X, it is lesser than or equal to a retention level, the amount that is paid by the insurer is equal to the full claim amount. But if the claim amount is greater than the retention level, the insurer is paying only the retention amount. But the reinsurer is going to pay the total claim amount minus the retention amount. Minus the retention amount in this case, or in this case, there is no difference. So in the case where X is less than or equal to M, the reinsurer is paying zero. Otherwise, the reinsurer is paying X minus M. Now, a few things which are very much visible, very much obvious here. If there was no reinsurance, the claim could be any amount. Which means very high claims also are possible. Which means the mean claim amount, the expected claim amount or the mean claim amount is going to be much, much higher there. Now, with this reinsurance arrangement, I'm able to reduce the mean claim amount drastically. And even the variance of the claim amount also is getting reduced drastically because of this reinsurance arrangement, because the mean is getting reduced. The variance, which is again computed by taking the mean, even that is getting reduced drastically because there is an upper cap on the claims. The claim cannot cross M, which is paid by the insurance company. The claim amount is not crossing M. So there is a kind of upper limit that came on the claim amount, and that is what is the cap that is getting applied. Right? Now, how do I typically compute what is the mean of the claims that are paid by the insurer and what is the mean of the claims that are paid by the reinsurer? Okay, let's look at that part. Now, the function, the claim function is f of x, right? I want to integrate it. I want to compute the mean, so I am taking it as x multiplied by f of x dx integrated over all the possible values of x. So this is the mean amount that is paid by the insurer in case there is no reinsurance. So the amount can be almost anything. So in case there is no reinsurance, this is the typical mean that is paid. So expected value of X in this case is coming out to be this much. So wherein I am looking at f of X being the typical density function associated with the claim amount. And if I am bringing in a retention limit now, right? If I am bringing in a retention limit of M, probably I am modifying this in slightly a different manner, up to 0 to M. I'm taking x times f of x dx, fair enough. But anything beyond it, right? Anything beyond it, I'm paying only m. So m times the probability of the claim amount greater than m. This is what I'm trying to pay. So I can very well use this expression to typically compute how much on an average would be the claim amount that would be paid by the insurer. And same logic, I can go for the variance as well, right? Because I can very well compute expected value of y squared from this aspect. I can very well go ahead in terms of computing. So probably if I really want to look at expected value of y squared to compute the variance, even there, I can say it is between 0 to m x squared times f of x dx plus this. I am integrating it between m to infinite. Anything beyond m, I am simply taking it as m squared times f of x dx. So So this is, and here also I could have used m to infinite m times f of x dx. Instead of talking of this, this is, these two work out to be the same. So I can very well compute expected value of y squared, and from there I can compute variance of y is nothing but expected value of y squared minus expected value of y whole squared, right? Now in general, okay, forget about one, two moments. In general, even if I'm looking at a moment generating function for y, it comes out that the moment generating function comes out to expected value of e power ty, which in a way is going to result in integration between 0 to m e power tx f of x dx, right? E power tx f of x dx plus e power tm, the probability of x greater than m. So this comes out in general as the moment generating function. But if I am looking at from a reinsurer standpoint, if I want to know the expected value of Z, okay, he'll start paying only when the claim amount is greater than M. So M to infinite, how much is he going to pay? He is going to pay X minus M only. X minus M times F of X dx. That is what is the amount that is typically paid by the reinsurer. Now, this is where one interesting point comes into picture when I have to look at from the perspective of the reinsurer, right? Now, see, the insurance company is transferring the claims to the reinsurer. Now, he may not get all the claims at all. The reinsurer is going to get a record of only those claims which have crossed M in value. So he cannot really get a clarity in terms of the typical claim distribution, because all the claims which are having an amount much lesser than M, they may not even reach the reinsurer. Means they may be omitted or ignored. So which means the estimation of the underlying distribution of the claims is very much difficult for the reinsurer. So whatever the claims that the reinsurer is looking is purely from a truncated distribution. He is not getting a proper distribution of the claim. Whatever he is getting is a truncated distribution. So this is where I really am interested in terms of finding out the probability density function of the reinsurer's claims, right? Because I cannot use the regular claims distribution in his case. I may have to depend on a separate distribution for the claims of the reinsurer separately, right? Now, this is where I have to really look at. Let's look at W as a kind of a variable, which is X minus M, whatever is the claim that is paid by the reinsurer, under the condition that X is greater than M, right? Now, and I am making an assumption that the underlying claims, the full-fledged claims, they have a probability density function of F of X and cumulative distribution function of capital F of X. And if I am purely convinced that the reinsurer is having an information only of those claims that are greater than M, and below that he really does not have any kind of a record of them. So I am more interested in finding out the probability density function of G of W, whatever is the claim amount that is paid by the reinsurer. Now for that, let's try working out. What is the probability that W is less than some small w? So for that, I can very well say this is nothing but the probability that X is less than W plus M. Right? This W is less than W. So I'm adding W plus M is nothing but X, right? So I'm saying X is less than W plus M, given that X is greater than M. These two are one and the same. Probability of W less than W is same as probability of X less than W plus M, given X is less than M. Now let me expand it. This is nothing but probability of X less than W plus M and probability of X greater than M divided by probability of X greater than M. Now, this is what is lying. What is the probability that X lies between M and W plus M? I can take that. Probability of X lying between M and W plus M divided by probability of X greater than M. Now, I can provide an integration function here, M to W plus M, right? This I can take it as M to W plus M, and I can very well take it as f of x dx. And the probability of x greater than M is 1 minus capital F of x. So this is what is coming out. Now if I clearly look at the small f of x is nothing but the differentiation, the difference between the two. So I could very well write this integral wise, I will very well write it as f of w plus m minus f of m divided by 1 minus f of m. If I am going ahead with the integration part, it becomes f of w plus m minus f of m divided by 1 minus f of m. So this becomes the probability that w is less than w. Now, if I really want the PDF, I can do the differentiation of this with respect to W, right? I'll do the differentiation of this with respect to W. So this is a constant, so I'm ignoring it. So this is coming out as 1 minus f of m times small f of W plus m. So this becomes the probability density function of W. So it becomes f of w plus m divided by 1 minus capital F of m for w greater than 0. So this is the distribution function as well as density function of the reinsurance payments that are typically made by the reinsurer, right? So for the direct insurance company, the numbers are slightly different, and from a perspective of a reinsurer, the distribution, the density functions are typically different. Now, the other dimension that I am looking at in this context is the proportional reinsurance, more and more a straightforward mechanism. Because irrespective of the size of the claim, the insurer pays a fixed proportion and the reinsurer pays another, the remaining fixed proportion of the claim amount. So if the claim amount is total Y, or if the claim amount is total X, and if I say that the retention level or retained proportion, right, if the claim amount is X, and the retained proportion, or sometimes called as the retention level, is alpha percent. Now it's as good as the amount that is paid by the insurer. Insurer is going to pay alpha x, and reinsurer is going to pay 1 minus alpha times x. Straightforward. Right? So in this kind of a mechanism, the finding out the means and all, once I find out the mean of the original distribution, I can just use a proportion computation to typically compute what is the claim amount that is paid by what is the mean claim amount that is paid by the insurer and what is typically paid by the reinsurer. So coming out with the distribution of the claim amounts in case of proportional reinsurance is much, much more simple compared to that of the excess of loss based reinsurance. Of course, we'll look at a few numericals that are driving all these things in the later session, but having a good understanding of the conceptual aspect of this is very much important. All right.